Welcome again to another edition of DNewTech. Tom Tran, he couldn't be here today, so he pulled me out of the hat, and I'm going to be the MC for today. And so once again, we're going to introduce our keynote or speakers, and they're going to talk first, and then we'll bring up the other presenters. So we'll start off with Maria. She's going to talk a little bit about Bizdom, I'm assuming. Yeah.
Hi, guys. Welcome, everybody. So I'm so excited to welcome everybody to our home here at Bizdom today. I'm curious, how many of you guys, is this your first time here? Welcome. That's awesome. Okay, good. So we're so happy to host DNewTech tonight. And in case anybody's curious about what Bizdom is, we are a tech startup accelerator, and we help early stage innovative web and tech-based startups to launch here in the city of Detroit and also in Fleetwood. So we're a nonprofit organization founded by Dan Gilbert, and we are really big supporters and fans of DNewTech. So glad you guys are here. I'm actually a little bummed that Tom's not here tonight, because I'm always glad to see Tom, but I remember back in 2010, actually, when Tom had the foresight to say, like, hey, you know what? There's this cool thing in Ann Arbor called A2NewTech, and I'd love to do something like that here in Detroit to bring the entrepreneurship community and the tech startup community together. And I thought, wow, Tom, that's awesome. We'd love to help you do that. And that he was just an idea in his head, and he had such good leadership and vision starting from just Tom having this idea to bring this meetup here in Detroit back in 2010 to now we've got over 1,400 members of DNewTech. So it's been exciting over the last few years to see our tech startup community growing. Just know there's a lot of great resources here to help you. If you've got ideas, this is your family here to help move things along, and we want to help you to do that. So welcome, enjoy the night, have a good time, and welcome to Bizdom. Okay? Thanks, guys.
Oh, and once again, I'm Maurice Tedder. So, actually, Ton is my boss. We have he has a startup called Kidpreneur. That's where we teach kids all the way, like, 5 through 14 years old, like, technology and entrepreneurship. So we have coding classes. We have Minecraft server build classes. We have robotics, app development, and 3D printing classes. We're opening up a new location in Troy, which is going to have an open house this Friday, so that's why he's busy getting that thing ready. Let's see, yeah, there's a lot to do between now and Friday. But all right, so now we're going to have our first keynote speaker here. It's Rayle Jabin. Did I pronounce that right? Okay. Yes, from Inkwell Venture Capital. So,
hi, everyone.
So how many people have heard of Inkwell? Okay, great. So Inkwell, I just want to come up here, give a brief background about what Inkwell is, what we're looking for. I'm one of the partners at Inkwell. It's an early stage venture capital fund. It's based in Birmingham, Michigan, which is about 15 minutes away from here. And we make investments between $100,000 to $250,000. So a lot of times we're the first money into a startup, or maybe along with angels or right out with family and friends. Inkwell was started in 2013 by Tom Lasorda, who's a former CEO of Chrysler. And there are about 22 limited partners involved, including Roger Penske and a lot of great people from different industries. So when it comes to making an investment, we're pretty industry agnostic. But what I'd say is we look for three things in a company. One, is there disruptive technology? Two, is the market big? And three, is the team great? And especially the last one is extremely important, because at the early stage we're going into, it's very, very risky, and a lot of times the startup's going to have to pivot at some point, and you just want to make sure that the ship is being steered by a capable team. So when it comes to investments, I just want to add a little bit of detail to what we're looking for. So I mentioned we have about 22 limited partners across different industries. We do have three manufacturing companies also invested into our fund. So when it comes to adding value to companies, a lot of times we add the most value to hardware companies. So Internet of Things type startups. And what I'd what I typically do. We don't limit ourselves to hardware, but I'd say that's look at our five and what we've invested in, especially the last few investments. There's a lot of times there's a hardware component to it. In terms of geography, probably a third of our fund is our company is based in Michigan, but we also invest throughout the U.S. and Canada. This is our founder is actually from Canada, so we do travel across the border here and there. And just a little bit of background, I guess, about myself. I was brought to the fund last year, right after graduating from the University of Michigan. I came in to lead the medical sector investment. Before this, I was in the medical school and business school at the University of Michigan. I did a dual degree, MD, MBA. I focused on healthcare entrepreneurship. And during my time in school, I did an internship, worked at a private equity fund out in Farmington Hills, and played around with a few startups and loved the entrepreneurial scene, loved being around entrepreneurs, and especially with all the changes going on in healthcare, I really wanted to get into the healthcare, the future of medicine, really, healthcare technology and those investments, especially at the stage we look at where it's as low as $100,000 going into a company. The ideas are just all over the place, and it's just fun working with entrepreneurs at that stage. Once they get later, it's not as fun. But so I guess I'll leave it at there. Just wanted to give kind of a overview on Inkwell. If anybody's interested in funding, I know I spoke with a few people. We have an online application. You go to our website. Ask you a few questions. You can upload your pitch deck. And we try to work really fast. We get back to you pretty quickly. We'll meet with you, and we hold live pitches at our office, Shark Tank style. And then we work pretty quickly through the term sheet and due diligence phase too. But yeah, I guess with that said, if there's any questions, I'm happy to take them.
Standing back, what's the biggest markets for you right now? What are the top three markets that are hitting hard?
So my focus is in healthcare. I guess that's a general answer, but within healthcare, I just want to point out. I mean, my interest is in the consumer health side, where you're giving the power of health to the patient. So in the case of our, just to point out a recent investment, we did an investment in a company called, the product's called Libby. They're going to come out in a few months, but what they do is they're a medication dispenser, an at-home medication dispenser that dispenses exactly the right amount of pills when you need it. It's cloud-based, it's owned and managed by the patient, but has access to pharmacies for refill and that sort of thing. But they're giving more power to the patient in that scenario. So that's an interest of mine. We are, with the people involved in our fund, we've got a lot of ex-automotive and current automotive execs involved. So on the automotive side, I think what's kind of interesting actually across all of the Internet of Things is you got to start looking at protecting the Internet of Things, hacking into cars. That's hacking into things in general. I think that's a big market that we're interested in. We had a recent investment in a company that is basically an antivirus for hacking into cars. It's called Sentinel. Sorry. Sentinel is a different startup. TowerSec is a company that protects against hacking into cars. But in general, we're looking at. I hope that answers.
I'm waiting for the third one. The third one. I asked for three.
Yeah. I guess that third one is. It's kind of tough because we look at everything that comes in
But what are you getting hit? What are you getting hit most with?
We're getting hit with.
Just go through your, your info box.
Okay, we got hit with somebody that invented a negative calorie food, also known as ice. So I got hit with that one recently. That was cute. The one that came in yesterday, that's basically a curate for food. So it does stop me. Everybody's getting pretty lazy now. You just bring in a packet and put it in this this device. So.
Thanks.
Yeah, how do you define disruptive when you're accepting?
Yeah, that's, I mean, it's a very cliche word. And disruptive is very difficult to define. It's what I try to look at is it sort of a breakthrough from a technology perspective that it's not a me too product. So a lot of times we'll see companies with similar technology but just targeting different niches in the market, and a lot of times that doesn't really appeal to us. So when it comes to disruptive, it's really changing the game, changing the way things are done. Yeah.
What's the breakdown of software versus hardware in medical entrepreneurs?
In medical, there's a lot of soft. So there's different areas in the med field. We don't look at pharmaceuticals, and when it comes to medical devices, we don't look at kind of the phase three, the more complicated medical devices. So my purview is kind of in, I do see a lot of software, and then I do see a lot of connected hardware in the medical space, but I do see a lot more of the software side because it's
cheaper.
It's cheaper, it's easier to finagle with, but in the end it's harder to implement because there's a lot more people that are that can potentially block you from getting it implemented down in the hospital chain. So I do see a lot more on the software side.
Say if we were coming into your office right now, like what do you guys mainly look for as far as how a portfolio will be set up? How would we go about presenting an idea to you guys?
Yeah, so when you initially apply, usually we'll hold a. So I'll talk about the live pitch from our perspective and what we look for. So in our live pitch sessions, we allot 45 minutes for a company to come in. In our room, we'll have some of our founders, limited partners in our room. And usually the startup has a deck, maybe 15 slides that they plan to go through, but almost never go through. So a lot of times what we're looking for is how the founder can answer the really difficult questions when they're around a big boardroom. But really, what I'd say and what I give advice when people come in to do a live pitch, I push them to know the numbers really well. A lot of times we'll come across CEOs that if we push them on the numbers, you know, what are your projections? When do you break even? What are your cost of goods sold? A lot of times if they look to somebody else on the team to answer that question, it's just a sign that maybe they're not in control or not informed about their company. So numbers are big. What I'd also recommend a lot of times is to really lay out what the problem is that they're trying to solve and laying it out in plain and simple terms. So even if it's a healthcare company tackling, let's say, a really scientific issue, the investors a lot of times don't want to get into the minutia. They just want to hear kind of the overall high-level goal of what you're going after, and then you kind of dig into it later. I wouldn't get into the details right away. So,
as far as a product, though, like say if I have an idea and this is the idea, but I have the layout and how everything I want it, but I don't have like the actual money to actually get a finished product to actually get out there and test and see how it does. You guys will want that first, or you want?
Yeah, a lot of times. So we've done both. Actually, we much prefer finished product and even starting to get revenue. We've done a lot of pre-revenue deals. As you go across that chain, you're de-risking the company pretty significantly, all the way at the beginning where it's an idea and maybe you have some framework for what you want the product to be. It's one of the most risky stages. So oftentimes, I'll say come back when you do have a minimal viable product, or maybe you do have that, but I'll say come back when you prove that customers really want this.
Okay.
So there's part of it is, well, if you do build it, will people buy it? That's a
good
question. Yeah.
You may mention a key decision point on your part is the team.
Yeah.
Can you give us some insight on how you determine whether the team is good or not?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of, there's a few things we look at. One is their history. So where they came out of in terms of previous startups, successful startups, but also not successful startups. A lot of times you learn from your mistakes. When it comes to the type of, does everybody balance themselves out? In the sense, is it just full of engineers, or do you have kind of a good balance of, you know, here's the financial, here's the scientific, here's a leader. Is there a good balance there? How, I try to get a sense for how, it's difficult to do, but how confident you are that they can execute the plan. And by that, I try to pose different scenarios of, you know, what if this doesn't happen, what would you do? And a lot of times you can pick that out based on how they handle not just the live pitch part, but when you're having those one-on-one conversations with the CEO or with the team, how they answer those questions is one of the most important things. I think that when you come out of a pitch and you leave the room just kind of in awe of the presentation, in awe of the way you answer questions, it doesn't matter what you're pitching, you leave a really good impression on everybody. And we've seen that, we've had that happen a couple of times where we were completely in shock and awe of how good somebody presented. Then we, after,
can you define what shock and awe means to you?
Yeah. I don't want to get into specific details of what they were pitching, but when you look back at it, you kind of think, why did we even consider an investment in this type of product when they just made us not think of all the possible risks, I guess, that could have came up.
So they had good presentations.
So they had great presentation skills, but to the point where, I guess that's a difficult question, but it's just one of those things.
That made you fall. You know, I don't know what that means, to be honest with you. That's why I'm asking.
It's like when you're looking at a fireworks. And they
what was great about the pitch? What did it inspire on you?
Yeah, I mean, from the pitch, so I guess what I mean by that is the pitch was so well done in the sense that they hit each of the key portions of what you're really looking for, the way they presented the problem, but again, how they answered the questions, with the poise of answering questions, with coming up with the right answers for everything. It's not something I can describe really well. I'm sorry. Yeah.
I'm just going to make a comment. I met Woody Allen, the guy that made the jobber for the cell phone.
Yeah.
He doesn't even have a degree. Smart guy, though. And I asked him, I said, what was your most important class you ever took? I was expecting electronics, but I don't know what this does. He looked at me and he went, drama. I was like, drama? He says, you can have the best invention in the world, but if you can't sell it, you don't get any money. He says, you've got to get up on the stage and you've got to be able to electrify the room. And so when they walk out, they hand you a couple million bucks.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a gift that salespeople have that I don't have, to be honest. I wish I had some of those skills to just kind of electrify a room. But some of the best salespeople, I agree. And that's what, I guess that's kind of what I'm referring to when I say shocking off. But,
okay, if that's all right. Questions, we have one more. Okay, one more.
So if I make, say you guys agree with the idea and I actually make that, you guys make the investment in my company, do you guys oversee it or you actually put somebody in place to actually follow?
There's it's kind of a whole range. We don't micromanage anything, and we want to be involved as much as you want us to be involved. So if there's ways that we can add value to your company, we'd be happy to do that. But at the same time, we're not on a day-to-day basis. A lot of times, I'd say with about a third of our companies, we meet with them once a month. With the other companies, we have phone calls either once a month or once a quarter, but they know that we've got an open line of communication that when they do need something, they need help raising money, they need help putting together a Kickstarter, they need help building a sales team, that sort of thing, or they need help with manufacturing, those connections, they can come to us when they need it. But a lot of times, every entrepreneur is different. Some of them are completely hands off. They just needed the money and they took that and ran with it. And they're doing really well. And then some of them really need some hand holding, especially at the beginning.
Can I ask one last question?
Sure.
Have you had any of your companies make it to the seed round? I mean, into Series A?
Yeah, definitely. We've had so a lot of times we've done investments pre-seed, seed, Series A, even Series B. But yeah, we've had some investments go from one round to the other. One of my goals, because we do so many seed investments, and I know some investors that only do seed, and their goal 100% is to take them and help them get to the Series A. They just crank them out, and they go from seed to Series A, and they've got that like a science. We're not there yet, but we've had some good success so far, and it's only been a couple of years too.
So. Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you.
And just a reminder of our format, so the presenters, they have 5 minutes to do their pitch and present, and then my buzzer goes off. I'll give you guys like a 2-minute, 1-minute warning, just so you'll have an idea. And then after that, we'll have 5 minutes for Q&A. So now I'll like to introduce our first, Jordan Warzecha from BackStitch.
You want this or do you?
I got my own.
Cool.
Have a receipt.
Oh.
And let me know when you're ready for me to start the timer.
All right.
Great. Well, hi everyone. I'm Jordan Warzecha, the CEO and co-founder of BackStitch. We are a Bizdom portfolio company, and our team actually operates right out of here, the 1528 Bizdom co-working space. Some of you may have seen us present at other various events around town, or even at DNewTech a couple years ago. But as all startups do, you know, the product's grown and evolved over time. So. Really happy to be invited to come and kind of do an update pitch, you know, a little bit farther along into our startup. So I want to start with having you think about something. You know, if you look at all the world's data that was ever created, 90% of it was done in just the last 2 years. You know, so anything that's ever been created by the human race in the last 2 years, 90% of it. And, you know, our attention span is constantly being, you know, attacked. You know, there's lots of things always starving for attention. And this is, you know, most of that, you know, it happens the most at work where we spend most of our day. You know, we're more connected than ever. We have our smartphones, our tablets, you know, multitude of devices. But if you look at an aggregate of employee engagement, it's actually the lowest it's been in almost a decade. Now, when I refer to employee engagement, what I mean is not just knowing how to do your job, but what your role actually is. If you look at one of the big concerns of leadership in companies, executives, things like that, is really this piece, employee engagement. You know, not only does it help from a financial standpoint where employees that really understand their role in an organization, they retain like 87% higher, so you don't have turnover costs, you have people performing at their highest level, but you know, for driving innovation and being competitive in 2015 means tapping into all levels of an organization and having everyone contribute new ideas, new products, new processes, looking for a better way to do things. So not only a financial impact, but a cultural impact into your organization. So where does BackStitch come in? Well, at BackStitch, we create what we believe is the most curated, relevant, and personalized content platform there is for delivering knowledge to individuals. So what that means is we have a whole suite of tools for helping organizations at all levels to deliver knowledge to people. We do this in four ways. One is by delivering better content. So being able to, at all levels of an organization, tap into both external and internal content and look for specific topics. So part of our software is an individual can go and say, look at, you know, these industry journals, these magazines, these websites, social media, internal CMS, and look for specific topics around competitive intelligence or industry trends or even new product research. So you have being able to create essentially an automated thing to go out there and passively monitor all these sources for information. Also making sure that's the most relevant. If you've ever worked at a large company, you may have gotten a daily or weekly news clip email, hey, this is what's going on in our space or with our company. And a lot of organizations do this, but virtually no one reads it. And why that is everyone in the company gets the exact same message. You know, if you're an IT guy, you don't care about the same thing that maybe your account service reps care about. And so we've really kind of built a platform that lets everyone at all levels really say, hey, this is the stuff I'm interested in. This is what will help me do my job better. Example, one of our customers, they build safety equipment for warehouses. And the engineering team's looking at stories where someone was injured by a forklift and, you know, what went wrong. Where their sales team is saying, hey, when one of our big customers is building a new distribution center and there's a press release, that's probably a trigger to give them a call and say, hey, you know, do you need help with anything? So really different ways to look at some of the same content, you know, based on your job function. And of course, getting it into people's hands is important. As I mentioned, you know, our attention span is constantly being attacked. So we're available on mobile devices, tablets, desktop browsers, as well as a multitude of other channels. So personalized email digests, if you have SharePoint or intranet, we have a full developer API and embeddable widget to embed that content. We even have a way, if you have TVs in the office, or you're doing an all-hands meeting with a big digital display, we can live stream content right up there. And then finally, you know, there's nothing worth doing if you can't measure its impact, and so being able to easily see who's engaging the most, what content is the most important in your employee base, you know, which group, you have various ways of measuring that impact, both with their own, you know, activity stats, as well as being able to work with things like Google Analytics or Adobe Analytics or whatever you may have in-house. So that was my quick 5 minutes pitch. And any questions?
Who is your key paying customer?
So as far as organizations, so we have customers that range in industry and size. We're actually getting a lot more interest in the larger enterprise level, especially because it's something that there's already people doing a lot of manual processes to try to improve on this engagement problem. And we're able to provide a lot of, you know, solutions in that group.
What level in those organizations?
So usually it would be a director of internal communications. Typically it is a function of either side function of either PR or human resources.
Is it a subscription model?
It's a monthly subscription, yeah.
What's been one of the most surprising use cases? Kind of as you described, there's a lot of different things you can do filtering all that. What's been one of the most surprising
use cases? One of the most interesting. So I'm trying to think here. So probably one of the most interesting use cases actually was a classroom versus a company using it. So we essentially saw someone wrote a teacher and education blog. They came up with a whole lesson plan using BackStitch to teach their students about bias in the media. So they said, okay, I want to pull from Huffington Post, CNN, Fox News, and look at the same stories, how they're being reported from the different different media outlets. That was something we never thought about, but we thought was really kind of cool that someone just kind of decided to use it for.
How are you different than the ones that I can set up with filters?
So you, with our platform, you can set up the filter. So you can choose both.
How are you different?
How are we different? So we allow, ultimate control of both where the content's sourced, as well as, we have a really powerful filtering engine, more powerful than you may have from like a Google alerts. And then we have a variety of our intellectual property. We don't currently have any patents on it, but it's all trade secret. So we have our own kind of proprietary system. Any questions? All right, great.
Okay. Well, no, I mean, when he was presenting, we had a now we have Brendan Rice from Tuck.
I'm ready.
Okay, all right.
All right, hey everyone, so thanks for coming. I'm super excited today to talk to you about Tuck. I'm the co-founder of Tuck, and I want to start by telling you guys a story that I think a lot of you are going to be able to relate to. And how many of you guys in the room would say you get really excited when it's time to buy a new mattress? All right, one person who probably doesn't actually get excited just wanted to raise his hand, because the mattress buying process is completely broken. So my story is from my junior year of college when I had to go out and buy my first mattress. So once I took the flimsy old mattress I had and threw it on the curb like this, I ended up somewhere like here, walking down aisles of hundreds of different beds that I was expected to lay on and fully clothed while a pushy salesperson stood over me and tried to tell me about coil count and different terms that I had no idea what he was talking about. Eventually, after I laid on a few and got pretty nervous, I decided, okay, I found one that I really love. This thing feels like a cloud, I love it. Then I looked at the price tag and it looked like that. And as a college student, or as anyone, you're kind of shocked by that. And so I ended up settling for a decent, pretty bad mattress. And I was like, all right, I'm done, I can leave the store. I think it was like the fourth store I'd been to, and I was ready to go. Then you deal with this, which is the entire process of getting the mattress actually into your bedroom. I'm sure some of you have experienced something like this at some point. Even if the mattress is delivered from the store, you have to get up your stairs. It's a tricky process. Bottom line is the mattress buying process is broken, and that's why so many of you have these negative feelings when you think about buying a mattress. Which is kind of crazy when you think about what a mattress means. You spend a third of your life on your mattress. It's such a personal product, and it's something so much more than sleep. It's somewhere you spend time watching Netflix on Sundays. It's somewhere you hang out with someone you love. It's somewhere you jump on with your friends. It's such an intimate part of people's lives, and that's why one of the reasons I started Tuck and why I believe that everyone deserves a mattress that they love. So that's exactly what we did. We started Tuck, which is a better mattress delivered. We're a completely online e-commerce memory foam mattress company. Bottom line is we've taken all of this and turned it into this. This is our website. Trytuck.com is the URL, and we've created an online storefront to deliver ridiculously comfortable memory foam mattresses straight to your door that ship in a box. So you just go on our site. This is the Tuck mattress. You choose your size. We sell twin XL through king size mattresses, and it ships to your door in 1 to 4 days. As simple of a checkout process as buying a t-shirt online. Again, taking that and turning it into that. How it works, like I said, it's free shipping in a box. So since it's memory foam, we're able to compress it into a box. It arrives at your door in 1 to 4 days. Now you might be thinking, how can I buy something I'm going to lay on for the next 10 years and never even touch it? And one of the ways we address that is by our 75-night free trial. So if you don't completely love your mattress, we will refund you your entire purchase price in 75 nights. We also offer a 20-year warranty. So let me introduce you to the Tuck mattress. 10 inches of memory foam heaven that will turn into that bed that you love, not only sleeping at night, but that you just get excited to go home to and jump into, and it becomes that kind of almost sanctuary for you. So we don't like to talk too much about specifics because we think, you know, mattresses are much more, like I said, the terms and stuff at the beginning is complicated. Mattresses are much more emotional than just like a list of scientific terms. But for those of you who are interested, it's 3 inches of gel memory foam followed by a 7-inch dense foam core. Basically, what that means, for what it actually means to you, is it's not too soft, it's not too firm, it's definitely not too scary, it's just right. It's that feeling of, you don't feel like you're sinking in, and you don't feel like you're laying on a slab of rock. It's the perfect amount of balance and comfort that only memory foam can provide. And don't just take my word for it, as you know, the co-founder of Tuck, obviously I'm going to say nice things. We recently launched, but we do have people sleeping on Tuck beds right now. And we've gotten great reviews from across the country. We ship to the 48 contiguous United States, and everyone, like I said, we do a free 75-night trial. So far, everyone's loving their Tuck mattresses. And just to give you a little background on the business model, because you might be saying, like, how could you take that $3,000 mattress I saw and sell it to me for, you know, $600 as our queen price? Basically, what we've done is disrupted the business model. We don't pay for expensive retail storefronts. We don't pay for huge advertising budgets, and we don't pay for those salespeople. Just to tell you a story, like Mattress Firm, for example, huge mattress retailer, they spend more money on advertising than they do on their actual products. So that's how we're able to provide you with the exact same quality product for a fraction of the price. Now, you may be thinking, I've heard of this company before. It sounds like a Casper. You know, that's the most famous one. And so these are all kind of bed-in-a-box companies that you may have heard of before. Where we differentiate ourselves on a few things. From the consumer side, we believe in our product more than anything. I have laid on all of these beds, and I can tell you we have a better bed. Can I get 10 more seconds?
Yeah.
All right, 2 is on the actual price. So we, like I said, our queen's $600. It's $250 cheaper than Casper. Finally, from the business standpoint, we have different marketing and different strategic positioning towards the markets we're entering. One other interesting fact about this industry in general, right now 5 to 10% of people buy mattresses online. That's predicted to increase to 30% by 2020, and in a $14 billion a year market, that's a pretty big opportunity, so we're definitely excited. To recap, ridiculously comfortable, the most easy, fast, and convenient way to order a mattress at a fair price. And, you know, since basically everyone needs a mattress, this is me and my co-founder, since we're out of time, since basically everyone needs a mattress, I want to ask for a few things from you guys. One is, trytuck.com is our website. I love feedback more than anything, so if you're willing to go there, and you know, I always love when I hear like, oh, your site looks good, but tear it apart, let me know what you hate about it. At TuckBeds is all our social media accounts. I'd love for you to share us. And then if any of you or your friends are in the market for a mattress right now, for the next month, you can use the code DNT for $50 off. Thank you.
Four more minutes for question Q&A.
What's the life expectancy of one of your mattresses?
You know, so it comes with a 20-year warranty. The warranty is really if, like, anything terrible happens to it. Typical experts recommend between 8 and 10 years that you replace your mattress. So it's standard in terms of lifetime of any other mattress, yeah. Yeah.
Do you have a business-to-business market strategy as opposed to a business consumer?
We are based on business to consumer model and direct to consumer model at that. So rather than, you know, a company, you know, mattress comes together, then they sell to a retailer, they mark it up 75%, we go straight to the consumer, which is why, again, we're able to provide. And we do some partnerships, so we might partner with an apartment complex or a group of realtors or something like that to provide a discount, but we're really focused on creating a brand that connects with the end consumer. So anybody, you can go on our website right now and call the number and you'll talk to me or my co-founder. We're very transparent with customers. Yeah.
So I'm guessing you didn't manufacture the bed. Who's actually being
consumed? So right now we're partnering with a manufacturer in Florida called Nature Sleep. They make a lot of different foam products. We basically just worked with them to find what we thought was the perfect product. Like I said, it might be kind of counterintuitive first to go and be like, you only sell one type of mattress. But that we really found what we thought was that perfect fit, not too soft, not too firm, all those things I said. So yeah, the answer to your question, Florida.
So what's your big difference here then? I'm guessing there's other people that are doing the same thing about shipping from this manufacturer in Florida. what's your big, what are you going to do to set yourself apart from some other person doing the exact same product, web days?
Yeah, good question. So really for us from a business standpoint, like I said, buying a mattress is a much more like emotional and personal process than going and reading like a list of specs on a sheet. So our goal is to connect with consumers in a friendly way, in a way that understands like why their lives and what a mattress means to them. So super friendly brand marketing, and then that personal touch of, you can't buy this exact mattress, but you might be able to buy like a memory foam mattress at like Costco, for example. You're not going to be able to have the same end-to-end experience all the way through that you will from us. Like a quick anecdote, if you buy a mattress from us, 2 weeks later, you'll get a box with a t-shirt and a teddy bear in it from Tuck. Those are the kind of things, it seems like not a big deal, but that level of brand connection and trust is what we go for.
But I don't think that's the question he asked. He asked was, they make mattresses, who else do they sell through? Are they your exclusive distributor through Tuck?
They are our exclusive distributor. You could go to Nature Sleep website, mm-hmm. But again, that's you're going to be paying $2,000 for a mattress.
Oh, okay.
So yeah, we have the relationship we developed with them and with other companies is kind of our what makes us a little bit unique.
Yep. So they don't sell to anybody else.
No, they do.
Oh, okay.
Yep. Go ahead.
Is there a proprietary design or spec that you guys gave to them to make the mattress, or is it something they just cut it and then you guys buy it and sell it as a mattress?
Yep. Second. Yep.
How are you generating traffic?
So right now, like I said, we just fairly recently launched. What I talked about, kind of one of the differentiated things, is our target and our marketing. We're really focusing on college students and recent graduates because they're going through life transitions that oftentimes need new mattresses. So the biggest way we're looking to spread it is just word of mouth, honestly. But to start, we've tapped our own networks. We're doing a lot of digital online advertising, social media, creating content. And then we have, for example, like we have campus reps, we have things like that to get out there. And again, when you have a brand and a product that people love enough and everyone needs a mattress, it starts to spread like that.
Back to my business market structure, towards business, opposed to business to consumer. Might be a good idea to go business to business with the hotels and college dormitories, get their brand reputation recognition.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, partnerships are definitely huge, and I appreciate that advice.
Okay. Last one?
We have one more.
Okay, I just bought a mattress maybe 2 months ago.
Return it.
And listen, this is the thing. You said about you put it in a box. I saw a commercial 3 days ago about they put it all in like a little foam container and carry it upstairs. It's easy. So if I'm a college student and I'm a senior, I just bought a mattress, got a new mattress, now it's time for me to move. Do you have a process where I can put the mattress back in the box?
So unfortunately, it would be awesome if we did. Unfortunately, that would require a very expensive, large piece of machinery. Once the mattress is unboxed, you move it like any other mattress. It's memory foam, so it's a little, it might not be as rigid, but yeah, once it's unboxed, which is why we encourage people to, if you live in an apartment with some crazy winding stairs or anything, take the box to your bedroom and then unbox it.
But once I get it out,
once you get it out, it's gonna be a scenario.
That's
what
I was thinking.
Yep. All right, thank you,
Brent. And next we have Jacob Drolshagen.
Yay.
From Seesaw. So he'll be presenting his operation here. And I guess while I'm here, and since Tom made me MC of the Blog My app, Graffiti Cloud lets you tag, freedom to tag anywhere, so lets you virtually create graffiti anywhere in the world and post it and tag it. All right, sorry.
Yeah, no problem. So I'm Jacob. I'm a sophomore at Wayne State University. My majors are computer science and marketing. So I would like to thank Brendan for inviting me to this and awaring me of DNewTech. It's a pretty awesome thing, if I say so myself. Anyway, I'll be presenting Seesaw. Without further ado. So I want you to imagine yourself as a small business or a medium-sized business. I'm sure many of you have experienced that, but just go back to that memory. So your company is having issues with marketing. They're having issues with capturing customers and gathering their information to further market to them later on. It might look something like this, where you you create a blog, you write a blog, and then you throw it to your Twitter, send it out, and your users would click on that link, and they would see this. A blog with a call to action at the end. And that it just seems a little ineffective. So you're thinking of other things that you can do, because often this is overdone. Or if you have a much larger budget, you would research your options, and you could see, okay, HubSpot. HubSpot is a really great tool, but it's very expensive. It's $800 to $2,400 a month, and it comes with this capture tool. So say you were to make a PDF book about marketing, you would throw it into this, and your customers would follow the link to this page, which would be an extremely large form for one piece of information that you really want, which is the email. Because an email is crucial to a business's acceptance. So my issue with this is content marketing is very passive and backwards. And you guys as business owners are generally pretty, you're aggressive people, and you, I don't understand why marketing wouldn't follow that. So I present to you Seesaw. Seesaw is give away content and receive a direct marketing rep in return. So with Seesaw, you would create a link, and you would attach content to that. And in order to get the content, the users would have to follow a stipulation. In this sense, you would I'm giving away a web kit, a web UI kit for users to make websites faster. And in order for them to get that, they have to follow me on Twitter, or they could subscribe to me on YouTube, share my YouTube video, or sign up for my email list. And once done so, then they get the content automatically, or it would download automatically. So now it's a pretty easy process, and it captures customers at that. It's very quick. This is how you create a link. It's three simple steps. You would give your link a title, and then you would give it its content that you want. So that could be a file, a redirect to another link, or a promo code or coupon code. Thank you. And then you would set the stipulations in order for the customer to get it, or the user to get it. In this case, you can direct the growth where you want the growth to happen. So if you want Twitter followers, you could say, in order for them to get this content, they would have to follow me on Twitter. Next would be statistics, which are crucial for every business. It would be total clicks and how they are pursued, or what avenue your customers took to pursue them. So it shows you what is effective with your customers and what's not. Next would be just even more statistics. So you would click on, say you would click on like this link, and then it would take them to this page, where it shows what users have done what at what times, at what point was your link the most effective, and just some general statistics. So pricing, the most important thing. Premium kind of model, where for 5 links, it's free. And then as you increase your links, it's $10 and $20 a month. Thank you. So how large is the market? And this is something that I had a hard time quantifying. It's essentially anyone who creates content and gives it away through the following media platforms, which would be YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, Dribbble, Google+, and then email, which is the biggest thing. And then this could include authors, designers, YouTubers, and businesses, and then anyone who's trying to grow their brand. Essentially, it's a very large number. That's it. Thank you.
Materials are you guys using to entice people to use the site? I mean, if I have a fan page on Facebook and I wanted to build a client base, what would you offer me to use your site?
So the biggest thing that you want fans, right? You want to increase your page's likes, right?
Right.
So in the case where you would give away something, say a book is a great example. You would give away a book, and in order for users to get the book, they have to like you on Facebook and give it the book.
So you guys, the range of products that you guys give away can be anywhere from
anything that you want
to a physical actual object.
Yeah, no physical actual objects. It's a download, a redirect, to another URL or a coupon code in the case that an online store, an e-commerce store, would like to give away something and receive marketing app return.
Oh, so if I wanted to use this, for example, for maybe like an app or something, I'd have to create like a fan page for the app, and now I'd have the fans like follow that, because it's not really for any kind of like applications or physical products.
So I'm assuming your app would have a Twitter account, right? It's
If I'm doing something that's like not really content, it's like I have an app or I have like a product or a mattress or something like that. So I can still use this,
yeah.
But I'd have people following the fan page or the website.
Well, you could do an email address too if you guys send out or if you advertise through email. Right. So this is essentially just a capture tool.
Oh.
Yep. Yes, sir.
Help me better understand what you mean by capture a customer.
Okay. Let me go. I'll go back here to show you how it works.
I don't need to know how it works. What does the definition of capture a customer mean to your company?
Okay, so it would mean more to the user's company, because they're effectively capturing capturing information to market to that person, and that gives them a connection to that person.
So they come to you saying, I want to capture some customers.
Yep.
You'll take care of it. And oh, by the way, this is my definition of capture. It says I want an email address. I want to know the first how many children they have, what their geographical location is, and how often do they go onto the internet. You would be able to satisfy me?
So the person, the company, would create an account, right? And then they would create a link. And the link would be advertised through their Twitter, which is right up there, the c.ci. And then once the viewer clicks on the link, it would go to this page where they would capture the customer.
Are you just getting an email?
It could be, it's anywhere where you want to direct the growth. Right now, we're integrating with Twitter, YouTube, Google+.
So you're not going to give me the capability to go out and, I've gotten this information under your system.
Yeah.
And to answer the other questions, you're not going to give me links to get answers to those questions. I have to go do that.
What questions?
How many children do they have, what their geographical location is, things along those lines.
I don't think they capture the customer. Yeah, it's capturing the traffic.
That's...
No, it's basically capturing minimal information.
But the most
important traffic is data. It's very critical.
If you get somebody's email address, you can then market to them in any way you want. So, I mean, it sounds like it's more than just email, but the main example would be
you get
their email address, and the more email addresses you have, the more you can market directly to your demographic.
Very well said, yeah.
Capturing a customer.
It's capturing the customer's information.
It's not capture of a customer.
I missed up.
It's just capturing
their email.
It would be capturing their email, which allows you to grab a customer or get a customer.
So what exactly are you getting out of this?
I'm getting a monthly revenue. it's giving them a tool to increase their email list or get more Twitter followers, effectively getting people that you know like your product. Therefore,
your
you can.
Competition?
What?
Who do you think your competition?
HubSpot. HubSpot is the biggest competition.
Educate you. I can sit there and pay X number of dollars and get a filtered email list of potential customers, including geographic location, etc., which is better captured. So just to try and make you aware of your competition.
Well, I think the difference there, though, is people actually interact with some piece of content that you put out versus guessing who would be interested.
Yeah,
in
so that's
I'm paying a company to give me those email addresses.
But that's not your own capture. That's not your own capture. This is someone, or these are people that like your content and like your material. Therefore, they may like your product.
All right. Now, before I close off the Jacob, is there a Maisha Williams here? Okay, so it seems like we won't have our last speaker. Apparently they're not here. But if you want to ask one more question, or two, since we
I'm free to open.
How many clients or customers do you have?
I literally just finished this a week ago, and I launched. I haven't actually launched yet, but it's done.
If someone in this room had a business that they thought might be able to use it, can they use it now?
Yeah, so it's at seesaw.io. it's I need to do a third run through on design, but that was it.
I kind of understand your market because as a designer, I have run into a lot of these.
Yeah.
And a lot of designers and a lot of people that work with like UI UX, they run into like this type of program, right?
Yeah.
And there's like pay with a tweet or like share on a Facebook,
exactly, yeah,
kind of stuff. What makes you different from that? Because like for them, it's really simple. Like you just say pay with a tweet.
Yeah. And people do. Great question. So an embedded app isn't as tangible as a link. So this could be used on a YouTube channel where people make, say you make like a programming video and you release the source code. To grow your channel, you could throw this link in there, and in order for people to get the source code, they would subscribe to you on YouTube. Or if you're a designer and you give away these things, you could put this link on Twitter and tweet it out, and in order for them to get this, to get like a web UI UX kit, they have to follow you on Twitter.
But there's already programs like that, so...
They're embedded though.
They're embedded?
Yeah, so they're embedded in like a web page,
yeah,
and this could be used for like other platforms.
Oh, so it's like a direct link.
Yeah,
I see.
Yeah, exactly.
So just to clarify, so if I say I have like a white paper, they have to go to something, like to a landing page, they have to enter an email address, and it shoots them the white paper. Do you handle the distribution part too, where I upload my like PDF to you guys, then it generates a link, and then as soon as they enter it, it auto handles the sending thing?
Yeah, so it downloads automatically.
So when they hit it, does it go to Seesaw, or can I set like my own domain or anything like that?
It's pinged through Seesaw.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let me know because I'm actually doing
some. Cool. Thank you.
So do you have any plans to track metrics for what impact people have seen between in comparison between this method and other methods? For example, if people have to fill out that entire set of questions like he was referring to before they get their result versus being able to just put the link and get their result?
This really only tracks the metrics that I get. It would be very hard to get HubSpot's permission to use their analytics. But this only really tracks this stuff. Any other questions?
So I really like your concept. So I'm comparing yourself to HubSpot.
Yeah.
HubSpot does a lot more than what your...
Oh, absolutely.
Your app is doing. So it almost, to me, sort of, when you said that, it like threw me, because it doesn't seem like a balanced comparison. Like, I guess when you're talking about it, to be able to say, well, HubSpot has a feature that is most similar to Seesaw, as opposed to saying, like, I'm apples to apples with HubSpot.
Yeah, exactly. So it's actually like apples to oranges, essentially. But that's the closest thing that I could find. And that's the closest feature I could find. So it's just different markets. Like, I don't think a startup could afford $800 to $2,400 a month,
sure,
whereas this is free to $20 if you're really going to afford it. Yeah. Okay. Oh, one more.
This is kind of a quick question that kind of triggered.
Okay, this will be our last one.
So you mentioned like HubSpot. I'll say HubSpot's a big platform
for a lot of
stuff. Have you looked into AppSumo? And Sumo Me, so it's a collection of these small utilities for prospecting, growth hacking. Do you see that as a potential model? Because this seems like very much like a feature versus like a big product, where you might just add more smaller prospecting tools that are, you know, I don't want HubSpot, it's kind of daunting, it's such a big platform, but I want something just to do links or just to do this prospecting. Have you thought about that as like a, you know, kind of similar
versus going against HubSpot? So AppSumo, from what I know and from what I've experienced, is they throw call to actions on the page, right? It could be like a top bar or a right bar or whatever.
They also have like heat map tools, the whole slide.
Yeah, so they have that, but that doesn't meet your customers where you connect with them, like Twitter or Facebook. That means that they have to come to their site in order to capture them. Mm-hmm. Whereas you can go out onto Twitter or Facebook to really get more connections. Yeah.
Okay, well.
All right, thank you very much.
Yeah.
So one last call, Maisha Williams, STEM Girl Network.
Nobody. Okay, all right, so let's move on to the next speaker.
So for our announcements, the next DNewTech is October the 7th at OU Inc. So if you want the address and things, just
go to the DNewTech website, and also you get the announcements when it's coming up, so you can check that. Now, do we have any other announcements for events somebody wanted to mention?
Well, A2 NewTech is in a couple of weeks in Ann Arbor.
Oh, okay.
All right. Tuesday night.
It is a sister one. I think that one was first, right?
Yeah. DNewTech is a spinoff of A2.
All right, okay.
Pretty much the same format.
All right, any more announcements or plugs? Or... All right. And once again, like some people want to be in the next one, so all you have to do is go to the DNewTech site and send a message to Tom, like tell him you want to present, and then tell him what your idea is, and he'll like let you know what your time slot is for the next one.
Just one announcement. Next week coming up, we have something called Demo Week that's happening. We have on Wednesday, Bizdom and Detroit Venture Partners are doing a joint demo day. On Thursday, TechStars Mobility Detroit is doing their demo day. And on Friday, the DeSci Accelerator, which is University of Michigan's new accelerator, and Cool House Labs are doing a joint accelerator. So really exciting for Michigan that we've got an entire demo week with some investors flying in from around the country to be here for the week to listen to some of our great Michigan startups. I know that tickets, I believe right now, are sold out for the Bizdom and DVP demo day and the DeSci Cool House Labs demo day, but I believe that there are still tickets available to the TechStars demo day, which is really a great demo day. It's at the Fillmore Theater. If you Google it, TechStars Detroit demo day, you should be able to find the link. So just pretty exciting for Michigan to have a whole demo week going on next week.
Now, for the Bizdom one, how many presenters are there?
So we have about 11 companies that are presenting between Bizdom and Detroit Venture Partners portfolio companies on the Wednesday, on our demo day. And that will be at the Madison Theater around the corner from us. Yes, Richard.
No, I was trying to get
started. Oh, yes. Yeah.
If you people like this, and you want to try and help grow, you can do it. You sit there and you contact your congressman. There's a whole thing going on in Lansing about reducing the number of dollars going to startups and incubators. Please, please, please contact your senator, state representative, and say, don't. We need to grow this Michigan in a diverse way. They're looking to take monies away from this environment.
Thank you, Richard. This is serious. Yeah, so do contact your congressman. I second that. We've been working hard to help our local representatives to know it's very important to continue supporting startups and entrepreneurship and economic development. So thank you.
But Bill,
there's a big bill on the table right now to defund a big amount of entrepreneurship support.
We've already done this, too, with NBDC has cut back. They used to send out a monthly list of entrepreneurial events statewide, and they used to geocode it.
Yeah.
But they got their budget cut, and they're only concentrating on big big.
They already took away the film industry incentives.
Now, do you know, the bill, what bill
it is?
I do know the bill number. I don't have it off memory, but I do have it, if anybody's interested.
I'm asking a question. What organization is doing lobbying as it relates to that bill? Because one of the problems that I have, and I have to be truthful, even though they've given money for startups, it really hasn't been a true startup funds because they're only funding certain industries. And my thing is, for true startup is not just funding certain industries. If you're only doing advanced manufacturing, that means you're doing the big boys anyway. If you're doing major advanced healthcare, you're only doing the big boys anyway. If you're doing a major advanced defense, which is what those three funds, they do those three, you're doing the big boys. So if you guys are lobbying to say, want us to lobby, we need somebody who's going to lobby for a true startup environment and to be able to provide funds for real startups, not just for those in those three or four industries that they've been doing in the last 5 years.
I definitely agree with that. And right now, the biggest help we've had for trying to get our state representatives to hear and vote against this bill is the Michigan Venture Capital Association. So the executive director of the Michigan Venture Capital Association has been very active, working very hard over the last 6 months to try to really rally support. And over the last, I would say, 5 years, overall, the Michigan Economic Development Corporation And other states, economic development, other state supports, like Ohio has been very active over the last 5 years, one of the most active in the country. Michigan has grown support over the last 5 years. That's why it's very concerning to us that suddenly they're putting the brakes on this. Like, whoa, this is not the time to not invest in startups and entrepreneurship. So I hear you on that. I agree with you on that. But that's all of us needing to have our local representatives hear our voices about the importance to support small businesses, entrepreneurship, and startups,
and,
right?
MEDC is key for the distribution of funds, okay, to try and address the issue that you have addressed.
But I guess I'm trying to get deeper, because I don't want to say support what you already have, because I don't think what you have was sufficient for me. I'm into the financial technology, and I haven't got a dollar
in fintech.
I have to go to London to get money.
Yeah.
And that makes no sense to me.
Yeah, I hear you.
That makes no sense to me.
I hear you on that.
But then I see you funding some advanced manufacturing thing that you pour millions of dollars into it, and it turns out to be a failure. I don't want you to keep doing what you've been doing, because what you've been doing has not been working.
There, I hear you on that, for sure. I will say, you guys, when I look at the state of Michigan and the support for entrepreneurship 5 years ago, or back in 1999 when I started my first company, and there was nothing back in 1999 when I started my first company. I was going on my credit cards, getting my home equity loan, finding new lines of credit, right? So things, as far as entrepreneurship goes, as far as startups go, there's still more support that needs to happen. But when I look even back 5 years ago, we had in the city of Detroit about four different main entrepreneurship support organizations for the city of Detroit 5 years ago. Now we have somewhere in the neighborhood of 70. So support actually has grown substantially. And it's not just, the Michigan Economic Development Corporation is the main agency that deploys state dollars. But there's also, for example, JPMorgan Chase Foundation has committed $100 million over the next 5 years to Detroit and the Southeast Michigan area. That wasn't available. That's shocking to me. That's fantastic. Something called the New Economy Initiative, which is a collaboration of 10 major foundations, like the Ford Foundation, the Kresge Foundation, the some major players, right? The Skillman Foundation. They have really been great supporters of helping to get additional support. There's a lot more.
Still not hearing you, though. I know all of those organizations. Yeah. Uh-huh. And still, at the end of the day, there are five industries that all of them have all supported.
I know the five.
They follow each other.
Yes.
And the issue is what I'm seeing. Yeah. I don't like the result. I'm just going to put it right on the table.
Yeah.
I live in the city of Detroit.
Yeah.
And I'm going to tell you, even MDCA will tell you, most of that money did not come to Detroit, because very few African Americans and Hispanics and Native Americans have gotten a dollar.
Yeah.
MCBA said last year, 1%. So as far as I'm concerned, what you've been doing is not working for me. So I can't support what you've been doing. I need, if I'm going to go out and support something, and then you want us to lobby for it, we need to really have, put some real stuff on the table and have some real discussion.
But understand, if it goes away, which is what the threat is, you won't have anything.
But I already have everything anyway.
But you will have less, because you will not have a nucleus that hears you. I'm hearing you. She's hearing you. We're agreeing with you. But we need a bit more time to do it.
Are there any
we want to get
but this is, but understand, this is not me. This is all
I know. I understand.
This is all of us working together, grassroots, getting the air of these folks one at a time. And I'm telling you that I hear you on that, for sure.
I hear you,
especially on support for women and minorities. And I know.
Software.
But there are,
medical.
Absolutely.
I'm telling you, it's all of us making sure
that this conversation continues and people know this is important to support, right? So I'm with you on that. Sure.
One other thing, if there are no more announcements, usually at this time we open it up and you guys can network, talk with some of the presenters.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how long we have this space for.
We got it for a while. You're good.
Yeah, fun. There's some pizza left.
Yeah,
there's
some pizza
beer,
left. So
if
you want to talk to the speakers or continue your conversation about the supporting investment. Anyone else have an announcement? Okay, so
thank you.
Network.
Thank you.
I learned a lot.